History as it happens, December 21st, 2021. Understanding Churchill.
We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
The man considered by many to be the greatest Englishman of the 20th century for rallying his nation as it fought alone against the Nazis is also seen as a racist who callously ignored starving Indians who sought to preserve the British Empire when history was leaving it behind. In the UK today, young activists do not view Winston Churchill as a hero. But does history need heroes? That's next when we speak to Max Hastings as we report History as It Happens, a podcast from The Washington Times. I'm Martin DeCaro.
And so bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for 1,000 years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.
I mean, I still find a tear coming to my eye whenever I write about Churchill in 1940, because sincerely and genuinely and indisputably was his finest hour.
In June 2020, as Black Lives Matter protests took place in dozens of American cities, someone spray-painted the words, "Was a racist," on the base of the statue of Winston Churchill in Parliament Square. Others placed protest signs around the statue until a fella who apparently did not appreciate the anti-Churchill sentiment walked through the crowd of activists and kicked over the signs. This scene of young people denouncing racism around the statue of a heroic figure could have taken place in the United States, where Confederate statues and monuments have been defaced or toppled. And as far as I'm concerned, Confederate generals were no heroes, but even Abraham Lincoln has been attacked for his mid-19th century racial attitudes. When we choose to honor certain people with statues or plaques, we're making a statement about that individual, but also our history, our values. So let's say you know nothing at all about Winston Churchill, and you pick up a recent issue of the New York Times Book Review, and you read the review of Churchill's Shadow, a new book by Jeffrey Wheatcroft. The reviewer says Wheatcroft casts Churchill as a racist, a hypocrite, dissembler, narcissist, opportunist, an imperialist, a drunk, a strategic blunderer, tax dodger, neglectful father, a credit-hogging author, a terrible judge of character, and masterful mythmaker. Well, I think that covers it. So, does such a man deserve statues all over the UK? Well, as our guest wrote in a Bloomberg opinion piece, Churchill was an unembarrassed racist or tribalist who described anti-colonial campaigners as savages armed with ideas. But he was also the greatest Englishman of the 20th century.
All the historians I respect try to see the past in terms of the past. In other words, to try and impose the values of the 21st century on a completely different era seems something very difficult, if not impossible, to do.
That is Max Hastings in our conversation with the great military historian and author of Winston's War is coming up in a moment. So as I prepared for this episode, I listened to some of Churchill's speeches to try to escape this current controversy and imagine what it was like to be a citizen in Britain in June 1940, after the evacuation at Dunkirk. And invasion by the Nazis was a real possibility. June 4th, 1940, the House of Commons.
We shall fight in France. We shall fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields. And in the streets, we shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
By the way, here's Gary Oldman playing Churchill in Darkest Hour, for which Oldman won the Best Actor Oscar.
We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender!
Okay, back to reality. 14 days later, Churchill delivered another spellbinding speech. June 18th, just a week before the French surrender would leave the UK fighting the Nazis alone.
But if we fail, then the whole world, including the United States, including all that we have known and cared for, will sink into the abyss of a new dark age, made more sinister and perhaps more protracted by the lights of perverted science. Let us, therefore, brace ourselves to our duties, and so bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for 1,000 years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.
You can see why Churchill is revered, and there were more than a few politicians and generals who would have sought a peace with Hitler in June 1940. But Churchill knew Hitler could not be trusted. The Battle of Britain began the next month, and Great Britain would deal Hitler his first defeat of the war. Operation Sea Lion never came off. Imagine if it had. So does this make Churchill a hero? Does his inaction toward famine in India make him a villain? These questions raise a dilemma in our minds, because people, societies, nations need heroes, right? It's very easy to categorize Hitler. He left no positive legacy. He is the personification of racial hatred and genocidal violence. But the problem with viewing history as a morality play is that most human beings do not neatly fit one role. Max Hastings is one of the world's preeminent military historians. He's the author of Winston's War, Churchill, 1940 to 1945. It has a different title in the UK, Finest Years, Churchill as Warlord. Max Hastings, welcome to the podcast.
It's a pleasure to be with you, Martin.
Well, we're delighted to speak to you about a subject that's very important to Americans, especially American conservatives who revere Churchill's leadership during the Second World War. You know, after reading your op-ed at Bloomberg Opinion about the current debate, controversy over Churchill's legacy, I wanted to ask you where it's coming from, because here in the U.S., we are having a reckoning with racial injustice, and statues of Christopher Columbus and Confederate generals have been torn down or peacefully removed in some cases. And it was prompted by the police killings of unarmed black people. But in the UK, Churchill's legacy is not unknown, not unexamined. He died in 1965. So what's happening there?
Well, I think some of us are quite puzzled because, as you say, we have not had, thank goodness, the sort of scenes that you've had in the United States with police shootings of unarmed African-Americans and that sort of thing. But there is a mood, especially among the young and especially among students, which is very eager to go right in there with the United States on this pursuit of alleged racism in history, and especially to look very carefully again at prominent figures in history whom we've always revered, but whom a new generation is saying, why are you revering these people? They did terrible stuff. They were involved in slavery. They were involved in all kinds of things. And Winston Churchill is the most prominent, and he's the most obvious target because his statues are everywhere and innumerable books have been written about him. And our parents' generation and my own generation have always treated him with reverence. So I see where the targeting business is coming from. But two aspects of it really trouble me, and I think trouble many historians whom I discuss this with. The first is that all the historians I respect try to see the past in terms of the past. In other words, to try and impose the values of the 21st century on a completely different era seems something very difficult, if not impossible, to do. And if you look back to the late 19th century, I mean, I wouldn't hesitate to say that Churchill was a racist, that Churchill had views on black and brown people, in fact, everybody except white people, which are completely unacceptable or unthinkable in our own times. But that was the way that an awful lot of people, most people in his times, saw those races. They saw them as inferior races. Now, this is shocking to us, and of course, we wouldn't have it now. But I've argued in a good many things I've written about Churchill and recent controversy that you always have to weigh, we're all a mixture of good and bad, that none of us, even the saints, I suggest, are all good, that almost all of us, you have to weigh in the balance and say, well, did you over the course of a life, did Winston Churchill in the course of a life do more good than ill? And the answer of most of us to that would be unequivocally far more good, that his role in the defeat of Nazism in the Second World War makes him a towering figure. But, I mean, I wrote a whole book, Winston's War in the United States and Finest Years in Britain, about Churchill during the war. And it seems to me impossible not to accept that he did do, I mean, some of the stuff he did was discreditable. And in particular, when famine broke out in Bengal in 1943, as a result of the Japanese having seized Burma, from which most of the rice from Bengal came, that Churchill's response was, to put it politely, insensitive, arguably callous, when the Viceroy of India, because of course India was then ruled by the British, asked for shipping to move relief supplies to Bengal. Churchill said no. He said, Bengalis will just have to, he used a pretty brutal, tasteless phrase, tighten their belts the same way the British people have. Well, at that point, the British people's calorie intake was about 6 or 7 times that of Bengalis. So this was ugly. Churchill's own contemporaries thought this. But again, I always say, let us come back and measure this against his extraordinary role as the standard bearer for democracy in fighting fascism.
Well, Indians were starving at that time. And we'll return to the India, the maintenance of the empire issue in a bit. About Churchill's racism, you refer to him as a tribalist in your Bloomberg piece. Yeah. When we call someone a racist today, it can flatten that person, right? By defining them with a single word. And in our modern society, if you act or behave or pass policies that are racist, you can be disqualified to a great degree from participating in society. But using that label on historical figures doesn't always help us understand the past very well. You know, these reckonings with the past are important, provided we're not distorting the past.
Well, I've always been one of those, we all need heroes, and I wouldn't hesitate to call Winston Churchill a hero. And one of the striking things about World War II, because he himself was a hero, he vaguely expected everybody else wanted to be heroes too, and it always came as a shock to him, especially when British armies were defeated on the battlefield, when he found that not everybody, not all young men in uniform, were willing to be as brave or as sacrificial as he'd been himself when he was a young soldier. And when he did so many courageous things. We need the heroes, but of course we have to recognize that these are flawed figures. And I mean, I'm writing a book at the moment on the Cuban Missile Crisis, and obviously dominated by JFK and Khrushchev and so on. And one is trying to look at JFK, and there was an awful lot about JFK that was deeply unattractive. But at the same time, I'm in no doubt, and I've just delivered the draft of this book to my publishers, there is no doubt in my mind that he earned greatness in the Cuban Missile Crisis, although in quite a lot of other stuff he did in his life, he was much less impressive. And one could point to all sorts of things about JFK, just as you can with Winston Churchill, that was discreditable and not admirable. And you pick on things like the fact that he gave a sort of tacit support to Senator Joseph McCarthy in his anti-communist witch hunts, that he was pretty equivocal about civil rights in the 1950s. So all this we know about JFK, but that doesn't, in my mind, change the view that he was, in important ways, an American hero. And it's just trying to persuade people, and this is what seems to me shocking, is that in universities on both sides of the Atlantic, the intolerance, and it's the refusal to learn, that the essence of going to university is, when you're young, we're all stupid when we're young. We know nothing. And you go to university, supposedly, in order to learn some stuff from people who know a bit more than you do. Well, a lot of the kids on both sides of the Atlantic are rejecting that doctrine. They say, we think we know this. We think this is what we think. And we don't want to hear anything else. Well, in a sensible world, you'd almost say to those people, well, go away from this university. We don't need people with that lack of humility. That the essence, even now, I am 75 years old, and I try to approach the writing of history with a humility, because I know, after spending so much of my life writing books, I know how little I know. And the notion that all these kids on both sides of the pond are unwilling to admit how little they know, how can you learn unless you're willing to learn? And that's what's being lost in these crazy controversies about people like Winston Churchill and major American historical figures.
Abraham Lincoln.
Yeah,
whose name
absolutely,
taken off a high school in San Francisco as if he were an irredeemable white supremacist along the lines of Jefferson Davis. I'm actually on the record saying I believe Confederate statues do not belong in the public square. They belong on battlefields or in museums because they were erected long after the Civil War, during the Jim Crow era or thereabouts.
That's also true. Yes. I thought that was a very important investigation and a very important point. And I've forgotten which American journalist, I forget, in the New York Times or the Washington Post, did expose this fact, yes, a lot of these statues. I have to say, it always amuses me, Riley, that in London, Whitehall, one of the most prominent streets in London, is dominated by statues of Field Marshal Earl Haig and the Duke of Cambridge, who was Commander-in-Chief of the British Army in the 19th century. Now, these two men are two of the least distinguished British generals of the last 1,000 years. And in a way, if you want to be logical, you can say, why do we have statues of these deeply unimpressive human beings standing in the middle of Whitehall? But as long as we understand what sort of people they were, as long as we say to people, now, hang on, look at these statues. Previous generations thought these were people they wanted to commemorate. As long as we make it our business to try and teach new generations that these were not impressive generals, I don't think it matters that they're there, and I'd be very against taking them down. But as soon as you start measuring the worth of statues and saying, well, these people have got to go because they were not very admirable people. And God knows, a lot of those generals of the 19th century, I mean, the British generals who were commemorated in statues all over Britain and who commanded British armies in colonial wars in which they did dreadful things.
So back to Winston Churchill now. And I understand I am speaking to one of the world's preeminent military historians. So chastise me if I am wrong about this, but I have always found Churchill overrated as a military strategist. Am I right or wrong, or somewhere in between?
It's as usual, somewhere in between. And again, it's all about measuring things in the battle. He was not the military genius he thought he was. He said to Clementine Churchill back in 1913 or 1914 that he believed that he had special gifts and special powers for the direction of armies. Actually, he was wrong about a lot of stuff. That the Dardanelles campaign in the First World War, which was entirely his doing, that he got the idea that because the Western Front in World War I, where the French and British armies were confronting the Germans and going nowhere fast and losing huge casualties, he thought that it was possible to attack the soft underbelly of the Central Powers by hitting Turkey, by going for the Dardanelles. Well, actually, this was a disastrous idea. And even if the fleet that he sent had got through to Istanbul, it's very doubtful whether it could have achieved anything. So that was a failure. And yes, there were plenty of other failures. And he had some terrible ideas between the wars. The British were then running Iraq. And he got the idea of so-called air control, where you could bomb the Iraqi tribesmen who weren't doing what the British colonial authorities told them to into submission. Well, this was pretty savage, and it didn't work either. And then, of course, in World War II, yes, there were failures, but he got the big things in World War II right. And this, again, it's a matter of measuring these things in the balance. First of all, he understood that it was absolutely essential to have any hope of winning the Second World War for the United States to be in and for Britain to work really closely with the United States. Secondly, when the Russians came into the war, not from their own choice, but because Hitler invaded, a lot of senior British people, including the heads of the British Army, they hated the Russians, the Bolsheviks, these bloodstained communists so much, they wanted to have nothing to do with them. And Churchill immediately saw that whatever he'd thought of Stalin and of the communists, that we had to work with those Russians. Roosevelt and the American chiefs of staff wanted an invasion, when they did come into the war, wanted an invasion of France in 1942 or at latest 43. And if that had happened, it would have been a disaster. So Churchill was right to resist that. And he got those big things right in World War II. So in my book on Churchill and the war, I've listed some of the things he got wrong. The Americans were absolutely right that he wanted to keep going with the Mediterranean campaign in 43, 44, 45, far too long, when George Marshall, of course, wanted to pull out of the Mediterranean. Now, actually, George Marshall wasn't completely right. One had to stay in the Mediterranean, but Churchill was completely wrong to think that the war could be won from the Mediterranean. Yes. And the Americans were dead right about that.
I'd like to return to the debate over the Mediterranean strategy, which, as you explained, has been raging since the Mediterranean strategy. We'll do that in a little bit. But right now, let's return to World War I and the Gallipoli campaign, the Dardanelles, which was Churchill's idea. The casualty estimates, they vary depending on which source you're looking at. About 35,000 killed for the United Kingdom, yeah. About 10,000 killed from France, tens of thousands wounded. How did Churchill survive politically?
Well, he didn't survive in the short term because he had to resign from the British government, and he was bitterly distressed. And typically of Churchill, having been forced out of government, he immediately volunteered to rejoin the army and went to command an infantry battalion in France, which reflected his quite extraordinary courage. And he spent several months commanding that battalion in France at great personal risk. But no, his career was briefly until the British Prime Minister Lloyd George brought him back later as Minister of Munitions, that he was out of government for quite a while. But he was always very bitter about that. I think a fundamental weakness of Churchill as a strategist, he always believed that there got to be a way of winning a big war by going round, by not taking heavy casualties, by finding what he would always calling the soft underbelly of the enemy. And one of the things I think most historians would agree that we've learnt about the wars of the 20th century, when you pit against each other hugely powerful industrial states, there isn't an easy way to go round. In the end, somebody has got to do a lot of killing and a lot of dying in a major frontal battle before one side or the other can win. And I think most of the historians I respect have reached agreement on that, both American and British. And the Americans always understood that. And the Americans in World War II, and especially George Marshall, they were very impatient to the British sensitivity to casualties. And they always believed that the British were trying to find their way out of doing the heavy fighting that the Americans recognized would be necessary. Now, actually, it's possible to sympathize with the British view because, of course, Britain had been fighting for 2 or 3 years already when the United States came in. But what was certainly true that the Americans, the United States and its soldiers generally have a different attitude to battle from the attitude of the British. The British, it's perfectly true, have always been trying to find some clever way of winning battles and winning wars without taking huge casualties. And very often it didn't exist.
Well, after the experience of the Western Front in the First World War, it's understandable why Churchill did not want to lose another British army, the last British army available in France again. Let's talk about the Mediterranean strategy. You alluded to it before. Franklin Roosevelt somewhat recklessly suggests to Stalin that they might be able to open the Allies a Western Front in France in 1942. Yeah. The United States was clearly not ready. But when we discuss the Mediterranean strategy from Churchill's standpoint, we should probably discuss war aims. Obviously, defeat the Axis, but also maintain the empire. And isn't this where Churchill believed that by landing in North Africa, securing the Suez Canal, liberating Italy, could then be used as a springboard into Eastern Europe?
As usual, the truth about the Mediterranean strategy is somewhere in the middle, in that you're absolutely right that the Americans were deeply suspicious of Churchill because they believed that he was pursuing objectives that in the war that served the interests of the British Empire more than the interests of defeating fascism. But on the other hand, where Churchill was right, the Mediterranean campaign in 42 and 43 served the Allied interests very well because we weren't ready to land in France. There wasn't the shipping to land in France to have a D-Day in 1942 or 43. And also, the United States Army had a very steep learning curve to learn what it was like to fight the Germans. One of the reasons that George Marshall and others have been so keen on getting into France in 1942 was that they simply had no idea at that early stage of just how tough it was to beat the Germans. But after they'd fought them in North Africa, and after they'd gone through the humiliation, the Kasserine Pass, and after they'd gone through the Italian battles, American generals did understand that Churchill was right, that you had to be in pretty good shape, and you had to be very strong, and you had to have a superiority of tanks and planes and so on if you were going to take on the German army. I don't think it's fair to call the Mediterranean campaign a waste of time. In the early years, when things changed was by 1944, the Americans were absolutely right that it was time to wind down the Mediterranean and to get on with the main event, which had to be D-Day in Northwest Europe. I would say the Americans were right slightly more than half the time, and Churchill was right sort of slightly more than half the time. One thing I have to say, which I've also said in my book on Churchill, if he'd had his way, I do not believe D-Day would have happened in 1944. He thought that things were going fine with the Russians gradually destroying the German army on the Eastern Front. He would have been perfectly happy to find reasons to delay D-Day until 1945. It was the Americans who insisted, absolutely rightly, that if the Allies were going to have any decisive voice in the peace that followed the war, they were going to have to get on and engage the main German army in Northwest Europe. And that was an American commitment against British instincts.
So I'd like to ask you now about Churchill in India. In your book Inferno, The World at War, 1939 to 1945, you write, "Most of Churchill's political colleagues recognized the inevitability of granting early independence to India and hesitated only about the timing, but the old Victorian imperialist remained implacable. He clung to a delusion that British greatness derived in substantial measure from the Raj and was disgusted by the perceived treachery of Indian politicians who sought to exploit Britain's vulnerability and sometimes rejoiced in its misfortunes."
And well, the so-called India secretary in Churchill's own cabinet, Leo Amery, was a very able politician. And Leo Amery wrote in his diary, I think in about 43, he said, "Winston is almost unhinged on the subject of India." And Churchill's view of India and the Indians remained that of the young cavalry officer that he was when he knew India in the 1890s. And that formed his view of India, and he regarded them as inferior people. Again, to even his cabinet colleagues, a shocking episode that obviously a huge Indian army was fighting under British command against the Japanese. And in that Indian army, there were, by the 1940s, a lot of Indian officers. And when the question arose about whether British, other ranks, private soldiers serving in India, were to salute Indian officers, Churchill himself intervened to say he wouldn't have it. He said it would be humiliating. It would degrade white men to have to salute Indian officers. And even other members of his own cabinet were shocked about this. But this is an old imperialist talking, but this is ugly. And this is what I mean. I passionately believe that no historian succeeds entirely in telling all the truth, but we have to try and accept the warts on our heroes.
How is Churchill viewed in India today?
Most Indian academics are surprisingly tolerant and admirably tolerant that good Indian scholars, I think it's amazing how forgiving they are about the British record, because the British record in India, it wasn't quite as bad as, let's say, the Belgians and the Congo, or indeed the French and Algeria and so on, but it was pretty bad. And a statistic I use in the book you've just quoted is that more British and Indian troops were deployed inside India, suppressing the Indian nationalist movement in 1942-43, they were employed fighting the Japanese. The British were struggling against the nationalist tide. But I think it's rather admirable that so many prominent Indians, both after independence, people like Nehru and his other colleagues of the Congress Party, went on record as saying amazingly forgiving things about the British. And there was a lot to forgive. But again, I find these days some of the young crusaders, whether we call them the Wokers or whatever, their attitude is they don't believe there can be any compromises about empire. You just have to say empire was bad and that's that. Again, the historians I respect, our view is empires are something that happened in the same way that the creation of the American empire was on the continent of the United States and the near wiping out of the indigenous people of the continent. All this, these were very ugly things and very unpleasant things, but we have to try and analyze them as things that happened. And it's not enough just to say, oh God, it was all so terrible. We have to try and look on these as events. And I'm afraid a truth that some people don't like to face is the fact that the whole of human history, sadly, is a story of the strong oppressing in varying degrees the weaker nations. And that's just the way that mankind's behaved. And it's awful, but we have to deal with mankind as he's been.
That's why I'm not a big fan of the word hero. I generally stay away from using that word.
You're generally right. When I was a newspaper editor, I had a rule that nobody was allowed to use the word hero in the paper without my written permission.
I don't like to look at people in terms of good and bad, good or evil, nations, good or evil. Let's move on to one of the more trenchant observations in your Bloomberg opinion piece about Churchill appeasement and the chapter of history for which he is best known, his leadership after Dunkirk and the fall of France when British survival is up in the air. Some American conservatives, they have taken this word appeasement and have twisted it in a way that distorts its meaning historically, correct?
No, I totally agree with that. Appeasement is a word that's got a very bad name because of the indisputable fact that Chamberlain and the French Prime Minister appeased Hitler in 1938 by giving him consent to take over Czechoslovakia. And that was a very ugly business. But it's very foolish to go further than that. If you look at today's politics, I mean, one of the things that the president of the Council on Foreign Relations wrote in a book a year or two ago, the US Council on Foreign Relations, that one of the things we have to face today is that the United States is no longer sufficiently strategically or economically powerful to get its own way about absolutely everything. And that therefore, the United States as the leader of the West is not always going to be able to get its own way with China or with Russia about everything that we might wish that they would. And so I'm afraid we are likely to see on our own time some measure of appeasement. And it is foolish that just because you couldn't appease Hitler because he was mad and he was one of the most evil national leaders in history. But at the same time, appeasement has become another word for opposing compromise. And this is where I don't agree at all with American conservatives, that I'm afraid we are going to find in the years ahead that unless we want to have some very unpleasant wars, there is going to have to be, whether you call it appeasement or compromise, on quite a range of issues with some very unpleasant people. But they're not as unpleasant as Hitler. I'm afraid I have a rule of thumb that no modern politician should try and compare himself to Churchill, and that George W. Bush Jr. sometimes seemed to try to, and Boris Johnson sometimes tries to do so in Britain. In the same way, you should never compare any modern enemy to Adolf Hitler, because Hitler was not quite unique, but he was one of the most evil men who's ever lived. And as soon as one heard George W. Bush say in speeches, compare Saddam Hussein of Iraq to Hitler, I'm afraid I shut my eyes, because I just don't think this is smart.
And father and son, H.W. Bush and W. Bush both saw Saddam in those terms, or at least that's how they cast the conflict. And when it comes to appeasement, this was British foreign policy for decades prior to Munich. Basically, it was a way of avoiding war.
Most of foreign policy throughout most of history for all nations, even the greatest nations, has to involve compromises. One's not going to get very far with having a foreign policy unless one recognizes the need for compromises. And some of them are pretty unpleasant. This does not mean you give in about absolutely everything, but it means you've got to be prepared to recognize there've got to be deals. And again, in the book I'm writing at the moment about the Cuban Missile Crisis, that one of the things that seems so impressive about JFK is that from a very early stage of the crisis, when the chiefs of staff were just saying, get in there and bomb them, or get in there and invade Cuba, that from the beginning, JFK was saying there's going to have to be a deal, that we're going to have to give the Russians something in order to get them to get these missiles out of Cuba. That, I think, was the measure of his statesmanship. He saw this from a very early stage. And you can have a good argument about what kind of deal, but he saw that was going to have to be a deal. And one's also got to remember that in those days, in 1962, people looked on the Soviet Union as a deeply evil force. A great many people did. So the recognition, it is just not good enough to say, we must not compromise, we must not appease, whether it's the Chinese or the Russians, that, yeah, we don't like the way they do things, but they exist, they're there.
And I should say a good number of Democrats in the United States also joined in on that appeasement talk when it came to the invasion of Iraq in 2003, as if Saddam Hussein, a tin pot dictator, was akin to the Third Reich in 1939 or 1938. So Churchill and 1940. This is why he is remembered, mostly why he is remembered as the greatest Englishman of the 20th century. I think that's how you put it in your Bloomberg opinion piece.
I mean, I still find a tear coming to my eye whenever I write about Churchill in 1940, because sincerely and genuinely and indisputably was his finest hour. First of all, because he realized there could be no compromise. One has to remember that many British politicians and much of the British Conservative Party believed, as I may say did many British generals, that after Dunkirk, that it was simply not realistically possible to hope that we could defeat Hitler, and therefore the smart thing to do was to look for a deal. And the big thing Churchill got right, and his biggest single claim on the reverence of posterity, and certainly my reverence, is that he saw this one huge towering thing, that Hitler was such an evil force that there could be no compromise and no deal with him, which anyway would stick, and that he had to be resisted. So that was the first big thing. Secondly, his extraordinary humanity. There are two or three things. One episode, one night at Chequers in the autumn of 1940, some people were saying after dinner, oh, well, of course, when all this is over and if we ever win, then Germany has got to be pasteurized. It's got to be expelled from the family of nations. And Churchill said, no, 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 no. He said, Germany existed and was a great nation and a great culture before Hitler came, and it will be again. Now, it's very easy for us to say that today, but the sort of generosity of spirit you needed to see that then. And another point too, France, which Franklin Roosevelt and the Americans regarded with contempt after the French collapse in 1940, Churchill always felt he had an enormous respect, a well-deserved respect for France and her culture. And all through the war, not only fighting against the Germans, but often fighting against the Americans as well, he was insistent that one of the objectives of the war must be to bring France out of it as once more a great nation and part of the European family. And he knew, I mean, there was a wonderful American military attaché in London who kept brilliant diaries in 1940. He made the very shrewd comment in his diary that the trouble with the British, he said, they've got to be kept on the front line and they've got to be kept fighting all the time, or else they're going to sink back into their usual sloth and lassitude. And Churchill kept the British manning their defences and building pillboxes and laying barbed wire into about 1942. And I'm in no doubt in my mind that, of course, he knew that for 2 years after that, the danger of invasion had departed. But he was absolutely terrified the whole country would just fall back into its accustomed sloth and lassitude unless he kept everybody going. And, of course, finally, the one thing one must never forget, he mobilized words, he mobilized rhetoric in a fashion that will define political leadership for the rest of history. And anybody can say what they like about Churchill and Churchill and empire and Churchill and race and so on, but his words, the genius of his words and the brilliance of the manner in which he really did inspire people. I mean, I've read so many letters from people of both American and British writing in 1940. You can't mock or deride the quality of that leadership, the quality of those words and the effect it had on those people. He persuaded the British people against all the odds in the summer of 1940 that they could do something that they didn't really believe was possible. And then he congratulated them afterwards on having done it. And it was something very remarkable at a time when neither Russia nor the United States were doing anything.
And it still is astonishing to think that even after Munich and everything that had happened, that there were still influential British leaders saying they could reach a peace, some type of negotiation with Hitler.
Oh, yeah.
That Churchill, of course, resisted. And one more question for you, Max Hastings, something that I think a lot of people aren't aware of. When World War II was coming to a close in Europe, Churchill had this idea that the United States or the Allies should keep on fighting to try to liberate Poland.
It was an extraordinary story. It's impossible to overstate Churchill's bitterness in the summer of 1945 about what had happened to Poland. But he saw very clearly when Franklin Roosevelt, a sick man, of course, until his death in April, had been very slow and unwilling to see. And that was that Britain and France had gone to war voluntarily for the defense of Poland, for the freedom of Poland. And now they saw that all that was happening to Poland at the end of the Second World War was that Poland was swapping the tyranny of the Nazis for now the tyranny of Stalin. And Churchill found this completely unacceptable. And in May 1945, he ordered the chiefs of staff to get the planners to devise a plan to liberate Poland by force against the Red Army. And the documents, I've spent hours absolutely gripped by these documents in the public record office. The chiefs of staff, who knew very well that it would never be executed, they'd been ordered by the prime minister to do it, and they did it. And they produced this plan, which is terrific reading, called Operation Unthinkable. And it involved 42 British and American divisions, aided, if you please, by the remains of Hitler's Wehrmacht, driving into Poland. And they used the word, the chiefs of staff, in their assessment of the plan, they used the word hazardous. I can't remember exactly how many, about 40 times, because, of course, it was fantastically hazardous. And, of course, the Americans took one look at this plan and they wouldn't do it. But it was his frustration. He cared passionately about the freedom of Europe. It may justly be said that if he cared half as much about the freedom of African and Indian peoples, his reputation might not be under threat today. But he cared passionately about the freedom of Europe. And there's a wonderful line in another historian called John Grigg about Churchill and Roosevelt and why Churchill really became quite bitter towards Roosevelt the last months of Roosevelt's life. And John Grigg wrote, he said, Churchill became envious of Roosevelt's power and Roosevelt became envious of Churchill's genius. And I think that was a good phrase.
I think Winston realized the sun was indeed setting on the British Empire at that point, even if he didn't want to let go of it.
I don't think he really realized. Okay. And a rather good newish book by Geoffrey Wheatcroft about Churchill, he's argued, I think rightly, that it was a catastrophe that Churchill regained the premiership in 1951 and spent 4 years as premier, because it was about time that the British people called time on the British Empire, recognized the gig was up, and started to look for a proper relationship with Europe. And having Churchill back as prime minister for those 4 years after the war, I'm afraid he did not serve. It served his ego, but it did not serve Britain well, because Britain's besetting vices today, nostalgia, this yearning for the past, an exaggerated sense of self-importance. And we would be in a much better place as a nation today if we realized we're a lovely, wonderful place to live. We're a middle-ranking, middle-successful power who really, logically, I think, still are closest to Europe, and no other alternative relationship is on offer. But I'm afraid that Churchill's return to power in the 50s, it kept alive all these old ideas about the empire and all these old ideas about Britain's importance. And I'm afraid to this day, there is still Boris Johnson, figuratively, is still standing on the white cliffs of Dover, holding up two fingers and making rude remarks to Johnny Foreigner. And he sees something heroic about that. And those of us who want to see Britain playing a realistic role, I'm afraid we don't think that this is very helpful to Britain's place in the world. But nostalgia is our vice. And Churchill, I'm afraid, if you want to focus on one shortcoming of Churchill, he had this wonderful sense of British history as a great pageant, which served Britain very well in many ways in the Second World War. But there came a moment when the pageant needed to stop and we needed to focus on the future and not the past. And this was something Churchill found almost impossible to do.
Well, it seems to me anyway that the United Kingdom and France are better off without their empires today.
Oh, undoubtedly. And I think most people today realize that that's the case. But it was a very slow business. And I remember my father's generation, it was a very, very painful business parting with the empire. An awful lot of them sincerely believe that the dominance of India was an important part of Britain's greatness. And looking back, there was something crazy about this, that Britain, this tiny island running this enormous subcontinent. Again, other times, people saw things in different ways.
Max Hastings, we thank you for your time today. Speaking for myself here, I find that conversations like the one you just heard often leave me questioning what I thought I knew about something. But that is a good thing. It is good to dance with one's doubt. And the next step is to start reading books about it. On the next episode of History As It Happens, we'll discuss a special anniversary. On Christmas, 30 years ago, the Soviet Union disappeared.
This is a victory for democracy and freedom.
What was seen as a victory in the West is lamented by many Russians today. That's next as we report History As It Happens, a podcast from The Washington Times.